Welcome to Cargo Film Presents. I'm Dan.
And I'm Dave.
On Cargo Film Presents, we talk about the latest in documentary films, review films, talk about trends, what have you. Today, we're going to be talking about Miles Davis, Birth of the Cool, which is award-winning filmmaker Stanley Nelson's Grammy-nominated documentary. It's a deep dive into jazz icon Miles Davis, arguably the coolest man on the planet for a period of time there in the second half of the 20th century. The film premiered at Sundance, was released in theaters before landing at PBS and Netflix. So Miles Davis, Birth of the Cool. So were you a Miles fan coming into this film?
Yeah, for sure. Who isn't? And come on, is it? It's not arguably the coolest man on the planet. There's no argument there. Are we kidding? Sure. I definitely am a fan, you know, and you know that I sound like a broken record often with these things, talking about how films are generally too long, you know, for no reason. Well, here's one I wish, you know, I would have enjoyed a longer cut, you know, but nonetheless, I think the filmmakers do a pretty admirable job condensing, you know, what is a long, amazing career to just under two hours. The guy was a musical force with few peers. There is no question of that. But I think what's revelatory in this film and this version of the story, and the big takeaway for me, is kind of how you're left feeling sad, you know, for Miles in the latter half of his life, right? As we learn time and again, genius and success never excuses bad behavior, and the way the second half of his life unfolds, his battles with drugs and depression, and the way he treats people, namely, you know, the women in his life and even his peers, you know, and the way he kept trying to stay relevant, sometimes successfully, sometimes not, you know, is kind of sad, you know, and then you get an impression that he morphs into a bit of a bitter old man. There's the quote that's attributed to him where he says, you know, God punishes you when you get everything you want in life or something like that. I don't know if it's word for word, but, and maybe he believed that, but I'm not buying it. You know, I just think it's kind of misguided. The story is kind of a fable of a man who believed he was, you know, the coolest guy on the planet and was treated like that, and then came crashing down to earth, not because he had everything, you know, that he wanted, but just because I guess he discovers that he's a mere mortal with foibles and perhaps coming at the realization that sometimes he's not the coolest guy anymore, and he's got to deal with being a jerk, and that has consequences on people around you, all of that stuff, you know. You don't get the sense that when he's older that he finds any kind of peace, you know, and I guess that's why I felt bad. I mean, the guy had an extraordinary life and career. There's no question. But, you know, when you see him when he's only 65, he looks like he's 85,
yeah,
you know. And I don't know if any of this stuff is true, right? It's just an impression you get from watching the film, because you don't get too many people talking about the latter stages of his life as a person, except for you know, one love interest, and you just get this feeling of bitterness. You know, he's still chasing the music, which is great, but you know that's what you're left with. So I don't know. Is it too psychoanalytical there? Too
no,
much?
No, I think that's accurate. I mean, it does really show you that often our strengths or our weaknesses. I mean, what his strengths are in the musical realm. You know, him being an innovator, always chasing the music, as you say, never really looking back. Like, you know, he doesn't ever seem to reflect on his past musical output. I think his son says in the film that he didn't even have any of his old records in his house. Right. Like, he just was always trying to find, you know, the next thing and innovate and create something new and evolve as a musician. And, you know, whereas maybe in your personal life, you know, that might not be the best strategy, not reflecting on your relationships or maybe the kind of damage that you do to other people in your life, whether that's your fellow peers as musicians or, you know, your family and friends. Right. So, yeah, it really was a kind of Yeah, blessing and curse for Miles. And I think, yeah, that is the feeling that you get. It is a bittersweet story.
Yeah, it's almost like a tale of two Miles, right? The first part of his career, although he did struggle in the early part of his career, but once he made it, he really took command of that role and played it very well. I mean, you know, the film is solid, definitely covering the big moments in his career, and it was enjoyable, at least to me, to get some of those. Some stories that I wasn't familiar with, which, you know, that's why I suggested it might have been nice to dig a little deeper in it, being a bit of a longer, or maybe a two-parter, three-parter of about the man, you know, in his late, and, you know, with his later years, where they puncture that Miles Davis mystique and the stuff I didn't know, like Betty Mabry, who influenced his music and his fashion in the 70s. Or him playing with Prince. Him and Prince were great friends, and they performed a lot in the 80s. So it was cool to see. And of course, you know, the film just really pops when Francis Taylor Davis shows up on screen, right?
She was amazing. Yeah, definitely one of the highlights of the film was Francis Taylor and her stories about her relationship with Miles, you know, both in its early sort of blossoming periods and also its breakdown, you know, both the joy and the heartbreak of that story. I didn't really know much about Miles Davis's personal life. I mean, I'm not a jazz aficionado myself, you know. I had a few of his records, and obviously, you know, you hear the stories about his drug addictions, and mostly you get the sensational side. So I did really appreciate it, kind of digging in deeper. I mean, you did learn about the immense physical pain that this guy was in for a lot of his life. I mean, it wasn't, it wasn't easy for him. You know, he had sickle cell anemia, he had a hip replacement that, you know, went kind of wrong, a car accident later on in life. And so, yeah, I mean, part of his life is also a kind of struggle with physical pain, which also is offset by, yeah, this sort of cool persona that you get, you know. Obviously he's sort of channeling some of that in his music. You know, I thought it was, you know, for someone who doesn't necessarily, is maybe a jazz light fan or doesn't know that much about jazz. I thought, yeah, this was a nice sort of introduction that you could enter into Miles's story and get to know him a little bit more. I mean, I was of two minds. I mean, part of me was, you know, felt like it was a little exhausting because it was a cradle to grave kind of biography of Miles. And, you know, you did want to linger in certain points. Like, it just felt like there was a lot of information, a lot of exposition. I was like, oh, wait, I wish they would sort of stop and linger a bit, you know, at this moment, a little more. But then you're like, well, then the film would have been maybe 3 hours long or something. But yeah, you really.
Two parts. I'm telling you, it should have been two parts.
It should have been two, you know. You wanted to know more about his relationship with Cicely Tyson, for example, you know, maybe just more about the music, the making of the music, the nature of improvisation, you know, and how groundbreaking that was at the time. Like, sometimes it felt like they just sort of rushed through some of the context with the sort of little, there's these sort of visual rapid fire montages, which tell you sort of what year it is and bring you to the next chapter of the film. And I don't know, you just wanted to sort of linger a little bit in that time period to feel just how groundbreaking, how exciting, how sort of like incredible that moment was, where, you know, you get this black man from Alton, Mississippi, who becomes like just the coolest, most iconic person on the planet. What that means both for, you know, the musical form, what that means for you know, African-American culture. So yeah, I just I don't know, I wanted more, but at the same time I was like, wow, this is already a 2-hour film, so
yeah,
what can you do? You can't, you know, you can't win. You've got to leave some things out. You can't please everyone.
Yeah, I guess for people like you and me, we would appreciate it more. But that's why I say, I think, you know, that's why they do a pretty great job, you know, condensing this story, at least giving you the highlights. And you're right, you know, they could have spent a lot more time on the music. But on the other hand, you know, they make do with what they have in this format, in the shorter format. You know, a good example of that is the The great story of Miles composing the soundtrack of Louis Malle's Elevator to the Gallows, and that footage, beautiful footage of him in front of the big screen watching the movie and composing. Yeah. You know, there's cigarette smoke furling from one of his hands as he improvises the music, watching, you know, the beautiful Jean Moreau on screen. And that created this kind of technique of improvisation that he took to, you know, he played for the rest of his life. And the next, you know, part of that story, you know, he returns to the US and gets John Coltrane and some of the other guys, and Bill Evans and so on, and creates kind of Blue. And with the idea being that if you surround yourself with great players and you provide an outline, you just, and you let them shine, that's all you got to do. And, you know, that idea of kind of being control from a sheet of music, the control that a sheet of music inhibits you creatively, he wanted to break himself free of that. So, you know, they dabble in some of that, and they certainly could have spent more time of that. But, you know, that is, you know, the big, you know, achievement of Miles. Just circling back to Frances Taylor again, I didn't also realize, you know, she was the one that introduced them to, you know, flamenco music, Spanish music, and he went on and created Sketches of Spain, thanks to her introduction. So there's all these little elements like that you learn that, you know, I didn't know about, which I found were illuminating.
Yeah, you get the sense, you know, the film really shows you how important, you know, women, Black women were in Miles's life in,
true,
you know, those periods in which he finds new creative forms and new expressions, you know, yeah, they're, and then also how sad it is the way in which he treats those
just awful.
Life. It's just, it's, you know, it's just,
yeah, that awful story of him asking, you know, Frances Taylor to, you know, leave the West Side Story musical, you know, and she's just great, you know, performer, dancer, and what a great opportunity that is for her. But being, you know, I suppose that's one of the things, another thing about the film that that bugs me just a little bit is while the film isn't a hagiography necessarily, it's not, and I'm glad it isn't, but there are moments where it kind of, they excuse his bad behavior some, you know, when he's being a jerk, like in that instance, you know, where he asks her to leave, you know, the musical, or, you know, and they, I think they explained that by, you know, Miles, you know, kind of, he was a jerk, and he closed himself off to people just that way he can keep himself vulnerable to the music. I'm like, come on, man, you know, that just doesn't sound right. So there are a couple of moments like that, you know, sometimes a jerk is a jerk is a jerk, you know, and that's the way it is. So no doubt drugs, alcohol, depression, all those things, you know, played a part, but people are complicated, right? And especially this guy. So,
and I suppose it's always, you know, delicate when you are, you know, making a film with the blessing of you know, Miles Davis's estate. Right. And which, you know, areas of conversation may be off limits, or you do need to be careful and tiptoe around. And that seems to be certainly, you know, one of them.
Right. Although I, you know, let's be fair. I mean, they spend time, you know, talking about how much of a jerk he was, even though they do excuse it in some instances, right?
Yep.
You know, a couple of great narrative films that they can spin out of his story that I would love to see. Well, no doubt there's that, the love story, complicated as it was, between Miles and Frances Taylor. But I also would love to have seen, some kind of rendition of Miles and Gil Evans. I mean, those guys seem like, you know, just great pals. I mean, certainly, you know, the one white guy in his life that he respected and seemed to have some affection for, Canadian dude, I might add. You know, their work together, you know, was pretty amazing over many years. I'd like to see those two films.
Yeah. Personally, that's the period of, you know, Miles's career and his group that I think I find most enjoyable listening to. And yeah, I think, you know, one of the things you do get out of this film is that, you know, while we love to sort of build up individuals like Miles as these singular geniuses, and I think you pointed out earlier, is that, you know, part of his brilliance is in recognizing the talent and creativity of the players that mm-hmm. he's working with. And he constantly does that, you know, as he reinvents himself through the course of his career. You know, he's always looking for finding new musicians to come in and play and contribute, you know, which is, you know, part of the equation of being an innovator and being someone who continues to evolve their style and their music.
Right.
And you get that sense. So it isn't just like, well, Miles Davis is some, you know, singularly freakish genius, you know, and that's it. It's like, no, part of that brilliance is the collaboration with his fellow players.
Agreed. Yeah. He definitely put a lot of stock in surrounding himself with, the great players. And did you enjoy all those Miles Davis impersonations everybody was trying to pull?
I did. You know, I thought about doing one for this, but then I thought that would be inappropriate. But I did enjoy.
Good idea.
I did enjoy, you know, that everyone had their particular Miles.
Their own take. Yeah. Although the guy, there was, you know, the actor, let's see, the actor's name was Carl Lumbly, who, you know, voiced a lot of Miles's book in the film, so it provided some of the context and narration from Miles' point of view. And I also enjoyed Herbie Hancock describing Miles's music as it was like it played like a stone skipping across the pond. I think
that's
this
right.
Was like during his cool jazz phase.
Yeah. Was it also him, or maybe it was one of the other piano players who said that, you know, Miles said, well, regarding improvisation, you know, I pay you to practice on stage.
That's right. Yeah, no, but I love that idea, you know, like, you know, it's they're fresh. You don't get any fresher, newer ideas than doing it right then and there, right? So, I mean, that's, I think, one of the, you know, amazing things of improvised music, you know, when it works, it really kills, right?
Yeah.
So.
Great. Well, that's all we've got for Miles Davis, Birth of the Cool. So we recommend you go out and check it out. It's, we watched it on PBS, but I think it's still on Netflix. Is that right? Do you know?
Oh, is it? No, I watched it on PBS.
Me as well. So.
Yeah.
Sounds good. So we'll see you next time on
Sounds Good. All right. See you later.